So let's talk a little bit about what has happened recently with MISP and what is going to happen in the near future, long-term future, and so on. So first of all, this is just a little reminder. If you're using MISP, what you have to watch out for is that we basically have the current up-to-date version of MISP in the 2.4 branch on GitHub, and we do point releases. So this means every time we feel that the release is ready, we tag it with a point release and we release it that way. So what we recommend to you to do is to get the latest point release version always. That's our official recommendation. Unofficially, we do consider the head of 2.4 to be stable. So if you want the latest fixes and the latest patches, it should be fine to use that. So whenever we add a new feature, we go through testing before it gets in the 2.4 branch. Our general way of developing is that very small fixes and so on go directly to the 2.4 branch. Bigger features go on a feature branch. The feature branches are then consolidated into a point release branch that where we put all the feature branches merged together, and then there we do testing. And if the testing is ready, it goes to 2.4. So this is just a little heads up on that. So that's basically it. So we don't need to talk too much about this. So what has been going on with MISP since the last summit is that we have used MISP as a very monolithic tool before. So you had MISP, that was the core application, and everything that had to do with MISP was part of the main code base. This meant that extending it, if you were not very familiar with the MISP core, was a nightmare. It meant that you had to dig into the PHP core, you had to understand all the internal mechanisms. And over the past year, what we've tried to do is we try to move away from this. We try to take parts of the application and make those separate projects that are interacting with MISP instead of being integral parts of it. We have a lot of these external parts not being PHP, so that seemed to be a very welcome thing for some reason for a lot of people. Don't understand why, but seems like people are not too happy with PHP. So the result was that we now have a small ecosystem of tools that interact with MISP. And what we're going to look at here now at the start is just to look at the overview of what these tools and other repositories are that interconnect with MISP. So the idea with all of these are that these are tools that are built for MISP but can be used with other tools too. So, for example, if you have already seen the taxonomies, for example, these are things that we encourage everyone to also use in other reusing other tools. While you use it in MISP, it's freely available for you to reuse and abuse. So let's have a look at the taxonomies at first. So this was the first big modular system that we had with MISP, and it started late last year in November, I think. Yes, and the idea with this was that people are trying to use the tags more and more in MISP. So tagging is basically a label that you put on an event, and they were using it for more and more complex stuff. So this can range from classifying data to telling the user base what to do with that data, and we wanted to have something more standardized for this. So the idea was to come up with a shared vocabulary that others can reuse, so we don't end up with the same thing being described in 10 different ways across 10 different communities. So we have this repository of vocabularies now that we call the MISP taxonomies. They're all built up in the same fashion, so they're using a triple tag format that first describes the namespace, so this tells you which vocabulary a tag is from, then a predicate, and then a value. So the structure is very simple, but it's also very versatile, and we have been using it for all sorts of different vocabularies until now. To create such a vocabulary, all you have to do is create a simple JSON, which follows a format. So the idea was that anyone that is not familiar with programming even can just sit down and create a simple taxonomy. And Rafael will talk more about an even easier way of doing it today, so you don't even have to create a JSON anymore. But the idea was that you should have no background knowledge in programming and so on to be able to contribute to the taxonomies, because very often it's not the same people that would be doing the taxonomies as that would be doing programming. So here's just a list of some of the taxonomies that we have. I don't think this is nearly comprehensive. We have something like 40 taxonomies at the moment. As you can see, they deal with very different issues. So it can have, for example, the Admiralty Scale one, the top one on the list. It deals with reliability of the data. And you can have the Circle Taxonomy, which deals with classifying the data. So you have all these various different taxonomies that somehow mark events in different ways. And yeah. But, by the way, one more thing, if you have any ideas for new taxonomies, feel free to open up a pull request with your idea and just contribute it, and we'll have a look at it and we'll
put it or in. Or even issue if you don't yeah. know if it's fitting as a taxonomy.
True. So, or even if you have ideas of what we're missing, or if you have an existing taxonomy already and you have ideas for how to enhance that taxonomy, feel free to do that. So the next structure that we did after the taxonomies were warning lists. The idea was very similar, so we wanted something very simple where we describe, I'll come to a moment what they actually are, but we wanted to have a very similar structure to building taxonomies. The idea with warning lists is that very often you don't want to necessarily block something from being entered, but you want to warn the user that it is possibly a false positive that they're entering. We already had a system in place from before that allowed you to block certain data, or that allowed you to block data from being exported, so we had two separate systems for that. But we needed something in between, where we wanted to give the users full control over what happens with the data. If they really want it in there, it should go. It should be able to be put in there, but they should have feedback that this is possibly false positive, and that's what the warning lists are about. So warning lists are basically lists of IP addresses, of values that could be found in attributes that you don't necessarily want in your system or want to warn users about. So it works very similarly to a taxonomy. It's a JSON file with a list of the values that that should be blocked, and also the type of lookup that that it should go through. For example, for IP addresses, we allow CIDR blocks to be put in the warning list, and that means that those will be resolved whenever you enter an IP-based attribute. And you can also define which attribute types should be matched against the warning list. So it is a very simple system, but it's also very powerful with what you can do with it. We right now maintain something like 30 warning lists or something in the MISP warning list project. That includes things such as top 1,000 websites, empty file hashes, so typically things that you probably don't want to put in there as indicators. Yep, and again, the idea is it should be as easy to develop as possible. So then the big one that we had, and this was probably the biggest leap that we had for MISP in a long time, is we wanted to move a lot of the core logic of MISP that has to deal with exporting, importing data out of MISP. This was a typical use case that someone that was using MISP wanted to hook MISP up to their internal tools, to their IDSs and so on, and the format that they wanted to use was not supported. It's a typical issue, and modifying it was very complex, because you basically had to kind of imitate the existing functions that were in MISP. You had to know about how the distribution system of MISP works, how fetching data in MISP works, and so on. It was not very convenient. So right now what we have is we have a web service that runs side by side with MISP. It's Python based, and it accepts, and you can just plop a new module in there and it will automatically be picked up. The format is very simplistic. Basically all you have to do is you get an input and you have to convert it into the into the output that MISP will then use to interact with the user. So as an example, for an import, the module will expect BASIC64 encoded input data that will then be parsed by whatever code you write, and it should return something that's a very simplified attribute format for MISP. So it is described as it's very simplistic, and if you don't even want to deal with it, what you can do is you can just split it into values and tell MISP to just go through those values and try to find out what they are. So we use the free tax import for that. So the idea is that MISP will use its heuristic logic to detect what those indicators could be based on the syntax. So yeah, so the idea with this is that we wanted to at first just replace the simple important export features, but in the upcoming versions we'll also open these up to the APIs. So that means that if you want to build a workflow with MISP where you reuse these modules with bulk data, that will absolutely be possible. The only thing that I talked about now was important export, but there's actually a third part of the modular functionality, which is enrichment. Very often you find a situation where you have data in MISP already, but you want to find out more about the data that's in there. So a very simple example is taking hashes and file samples and doing virus total lookups against it. So that's the third type of module that we have, the enrichment modules. These also allow you to build something that we call hover modules, that's hovering over a value in MISP over an attribute will immediately give feedback on what all of these modules find that are run against it. The system is very simple in a way that you describe in the module what kind of attributes it should run against and when it should trigger. So if it should trigger on a hover or if it should only trigger if you want an expansion. So it's basically a few settings at the top of the script. Then you have your small lookup script, and that's basically all you need to do. Small for modules are something like 30 lines of Python code or something.
Not even more.
probably even less, yeah. So it's really easy to write them. So if you have any ideas and you want to connect MISP to some tools, feel free to open a pull request with it. So that was the whole idea behind it, to make this as simple as possible for you guys. Mm-hmm. So just let us know if you have any ideas for that. Okay. So yeah, so here are some example modules that we have already. So for enrichment, for example, one of the first modules that we got with it was Passive Total, which is also one of the most comprehensive modules that we have probably. It's really something that, worth looking into how it works internally, because it's a good thing to emulate when you're building modules. Then we also have the Circle Passive SSL Passive DNS modules. They are much more focused in what they do, but it works really well. I mean, one of the other things is that if you have a service that you want to open up to MISP, MISP allows you to set up API keys, passwords, and so on directly as a site admin. So that means that if you're a feed provider or a service provider, building a module for your service might enable customers that are purchasing your services to use it via MISP. Okay, so for import-export, for import, one of the first things we got was a simplistic sticks module. We're going to get something more complex than that in the near future when we refactor an external tool that we have. And another thing was that Alexon did during a hackathon was the OCR module. If you have some frenemies that still send you reports in images, PDFs, and so on, you can just OCR the fax. You can OCR it, and it will automatically try to parse any indicators from the parsed image and create attributes out of them automatically. And then for export, just an example, we have a Ceph export. So if you have an event, you can export in Ceph format through this module. Again, it's a few hundred lines of code, or not even that, for the full mapping. Okay. So this was the general big picture that we're working on, so basically modularity. But let's look at some of the actual features that we've built in recent times. So one example for that is the feed system. So this all started a little while ago with MISP feeds. So the idea was that even though MISP exchanges data with other MISP through the synchronization system, you might run into a situation where you want to exchange data out of bound. So that might happen, for example, if you have aircraft systems. If you simply want to share with anyone out there that can reach your website. So, for example, if you want to provide an OSINT feed that's available for everyone, you don't necessarily want to set up a synchronization link with each one of them. So what you can do with the MISP feeds is you can generate a MISP feed with a script that we provide via PyMISP. Basically, all it does is it exports a subset of the data that you define based on filters, for example, tags, distribution levels, and so on. And it generates a directory with JSON files for each event and the manifest that tells MISP what kind of events to expect when browsing that feed. The good thing is that it works exactly like a remote instance, so you can view the events before you pull them, so you can explore the contents of a feed. You can you can browse, filter events as you would with a normal MISP instance, and then decide and cherry pick the data that you want to hatch. Right. So one of the big new changes for this is that we've also added the possibility to use other types of feeds than MISP feeds. So the idea is that if you know a feed that's in CSV format, for example, you can tell MISP to just go fetch that data and try to parse the data from there based on some rules. So for example, the most simple is you can tell it which row to look for to fetch from the feed, and then let MISP auto parse the stuff that it finds, the IP addresses, domain names, and so on. So it's pretty simplistic, but it works pretty well. You can also define also sorts of rules with what to do with this data. Should they end up with a new event each time you pull it? Should they go concentrated into the same place? And should it be published automatically, and so on? So yep, that's basically for feeds. Yep. Another new thing is the internal synchronization mechanism. So very often, and this is something that we encourage, is organizations might run more than one MISP instance. For example, if you run an internal instance that you just use for sandboxing, where you put all your raw junk data in, that's not necessarily something that you want to share with the community. You want to take a subset of it. So you might have an external MISP where you exchange data with partners, and you have this internal junk MISP. But the issue with that was that you have to move the data over from your internal MISP that you actually want to share, and MISP mechanisms will downgrade distribution levels and so on by default when you do that. And the if you set up an internal synchronization between those two instances, all of these rules will be ignored. Data will be copied one-to-one between those two instances, and you can cherry pick the data that you want to move over. So this just enables this additional use case. It has all sorts of protection mechanisms in it, so you don't accidentally set up an internal synchronization with an external partner. So that would not be too great. So it, for example, expects the internal setting of MISP of the host organization to match that of the remote instance's host organization, and so on. So yeah, for other integration options that we have recently added, one of the interesting ones was contributed by CERN is the Bro export. So that was one of the very we have a feature hub page where people can vote on features, and this was a pretty active one over there. And another thing that happened recently was a rework of the Styx export. So one of the issues that we had before was dealing with massive bulk data in Styx and exporting that, which was an absolute nightmare to do, so that shouldn't happen anymore. It's still a nightmare to deal with big Styx files, but at least it won't be a disaster from MISP perspective, so at least we're safe there. Then some other smaller features, such as inline screenshots within MISP. So one of the use cases was uploading screenshots from Cuckoo directly to MISP while it was executing. So you can now have that, and you have little thumbnails for them directly. Just a small touch. Then you have additional authentication mechanism. The latest one that we got was also from CERN, was the Shibboleth authentication. And then besides that, we usually have a massive list of smaller features, improvements, and so on. So we generally maintain a changelog with each point release, and that should detail it. I mean, going through that is a bit massive, but if you're welcome to just go through it if you feel like it. Okay, so this is what has happened recently, but let's have a look at what we're working on right now. So basically, we generally don't have a very fixed long-term plan. We usually have a fixed, very short-term plan for the next few releases that will happen within the next 2-3 weeks or something. So let's have a look at that first. So the next one that we're going to release, and that should be within a few days, hopefully, yes, it will be a small rework of how the feeds work. So one of the things that you want to do is, right now you can assign a tag to a feed, and every event that comes in through a feed will be tagged with that tag. We want you to be able to mix and match several tags, because it was a bit too restrictive. We also are working on an internal taxonomy for MISP. That means that these will be tags that are that all carry code with them. So that means that each one of those tags MISP will have to handle differently. the normal tag. So an example for this is that we want to create correlation-only events. So that would be a tag, reserve namespace that you cannot touch as a user. So if an event is marked as a correlation-only event, it will be hidden from the index, but it will still correlate. So the idea is that if you pull feed data, you don't necessarily want to distribute that to others because they will probably pull the feed data too, so it will just create duplicates, but you still want the correlations for all your users on your instance. So this is just an idea for that. For the version after that, 2.4.54, and this is something that's been in the works for a longer time, is a rework of the import and export APIs. Right now we have a long list of APIs and it's a bit of a mess. They don't have a consistent set of parameters that you can use to filter data. We want to rework all that, have one API, export, you set the type, what the output format should be, and set the same consistent parameters for it. And the good idea, and the interesting idea with this is that we want to expose all the modules to that as well. So right now it's using only the internal export mechanisms, but what we want to do is if you add, a new sticks export module, it should be routed through that and go through the export API. So, yep. So that's basically for this. And another idea, of course, is that right now for the feeds, we allow them, as I mentioned, the MISP format feeds, the CSV format, and the free text format feeds, but we also want to use the module system for that. So route it through the modules, detect what indicators are behind that feed format using the modules, and then store it within MISP. Okay, here the version is wrong, it should be 55. So this is another thing that is currently a little bit wonky in MISP, it's the scheduled tasks. The idea is to rework it into a much more granular and simpler to use interface. The idea is that right now we have all of these export features, but you cannot reuse those for the cached exports. So cached exports are very simple, export everything for every organization without any filters. It's not very useful. What we want to do is we want you to be able to set up filters, granularly export certain types of exports with certain settings at regular intervals, however you want to set up and mix and match them. So this is just something that's coming. Another interesting idea with this is that you will be able to do the same with feeds. So we want you to be able to pull feeds at different regular intervals instead of just saying pull all feeds, pull all instances, and so on. Right. And for 2.4.56, this is already venturing a little bit into the slightly longer term, but so this might already change a bit. One of the big things that Alexander had mentioned was attribute level tagging. So the idea with this is, right now you can tag events and it's really useful. You can use it to block what's being exported, so you can set up filters for your API, tools that fetch data from MISP. But it's not granular enough, so we want it on attribute level too. This will allow us to, for example, set expiration tags as well. So it's a huge step forward, and this is built by someone from Siemens and it's almost there. So we're very close to adding this actually. But we want to add some additional things to it, such as I already mentioned the internal tags, but tags with variable components. So that is one of the big things that we need right now. Tags are fixed completely in value. So if you have a tag that says TLP red, that is always going to be TLP red. But for example, for expiration, you have a variable component, which should be a time value. And we want to have a variable stored within the connector that connects the tag to the structure that it's attached to, and then you would have, for example, an expiration time set in that variable, and then it would be able to execute those. Okay, some other ideas are Boolean tags and so on. Okay, so for the midterm, this is not set yet which version it will come, but expect it soon. One of them is the MISP Galaxies, and this is a pretty big project that's going side by side with MISP that deals with building threat intel-based vocabularies and repositories for MISP. So one of the big ones that's, that Alexander is working on is the threat actor repository. So right now what people are doing, they're putting threat actor name as a tag on an event, which is great, but threat actors carry are more complex than just a tag. So they can have aliases, they can have additional information such as country of origin and so on. And you want all of this information shared together with an event. So our ideas for galaxies are to have basically these CTI structures sitting on top of events. At the first implementation stage, what we want to do is we want to use these open repositories that people are contributing to and attach those structures to events. So this will be just the first stage. So so this is pretty rigid in style. You will have a big list of threat actors and to choose from with all the additional metadata that is being shared with them, and you can attach those to attributes or to events and so on. So expect this pretty soon, and then we'll have a rework of this in the longer term that will allow you to do more, but we'll talk a little bit later about that. Okay, so here is just some examples of what the current threat actor galaxy looks like, or just a small snippet of it. Feel free to look around there and to make suggestions on how we can improve it. So we're always looking for contributions on additional information, additional ideas, how we can do it better than we do it currently. So as you can see, it's also just JSON files, just like taxonomies and warning lists. So editing it should be pretty easy. And as you can see here, we have some synonyms, country, references, description, and so on. So everything that that might have to do with a threat actor and that you might want to share together with your event. So this is just another example for tools used and so on. And the idea is that internally in MISP, all of these will be key values that will be built based on these templates that we that are in the galaxies. Yep. So okay, let's move on. So let's look at some other features that we want to do on the midterm. So right now modules are completely in sync. So what that means that if you query a module, MISP will wait for the response from that and then display it to the user. But one of the things you want to do in the future, for example, is you want you to be able to trigger sandboxes from MISP. So send a sample to a sandbox, let it run, and then get the result of it back. So we want to have async modules that we want to have an inbox system where you get the results back from executed modules and then deal with them later. Another thing that we want to do, and this is also, it might move to the shorter term because it's not as big of a change, but it's pretty urgent, is to be able to override attributes that are false positives locally. So right now we don't have a system for this in place. If you have a false positive, you need to create a proposal and you have to wait for the original event creator to accept it, and it's a bit of a nightmare. So what we want to do is we want to have a local override for those attributes already if it has a proposal. So that means if you create a proposal for it, it should immediately override it for you until it is accepted or discarded. So this is new import and export modules. That's a constant for us. Whenever we get some ideas on what's missing, we try to make some time for it and implement it. Another thing, and this is also very interesting, is a rule-based tag translation system. So I couldn't find a better name for this, but the idea is that right now when you synchronize data, your partner might use different taxonomies to describe the same thing what you were describing internally using something else. So what we want to do is, where it makes sense, to allow you to build translation tables for these taxonomies. So for example, if you have one taxonomy describing phishing in one way and you use a different internal taxonomy to describe phishing, allow you to link those two and automatically put the other tag on incoming events from synchronization. Another thing is that right now the feeds and the module systems, they are, for feeds it's very simple. If you it's completely unauthenticated, just browse it, fetch the data from it. But one of the things that we had in mind is that we might have feed vendors that want to sell their data through MISP. And one of the weaknesses that we have right now is that if you put a feed out there, everyone can see it, of course, unless you use reverse proxies and so on, which is of course possible, but it's an extra hassle. So we want to allow the feed system to use authentication. So this is just something that we have to look into, what authentication methods you want to support, and then just do it. And then the same thing with modules. Modules right now are meant to be run internally within your own infrastructure, and MISP connects to those modules. Usually you run them on the same system, but not necessarily. But what we want to do is we want to be able to have distributed modules. So we need an authentication system for that as well. And it's something that we're also going to look into soon. So another thing is that right now, all the settings in MISP are affecting the entire instance. So we don't have anything where a user can customize MISP for themselves. So the idea here is that, for example, you have some users that are interested in some functionality based on their role, for example, and some other users might not be interested in the same thing. So we want to have a user setting system where users can select what they're interested in, what fields they want to see, and so on. So this is something that's long overdue, and we have a lot of features that are kind of dependent on this. So it's something that we'll definitely have to do sooner or later. For longer term, and this is, we will do it, but we don't know yet when, or most of them we will do. So one of the big ones here is to have a way of creating, instead of the flat attributes that we have, combined objects within MISP instead of our current attributes. For example, if you have a file that you're describing, a file will have more than one or two values that you want to convey about them. They will have different hashes, file name, file size, and so on. And the idea with this is that you want to be to have a templating system that allows you to bundle all of this data within an event in a kind of encapsulated way. So this is also an ongoing project where we're trying to already define the basic objects that we want to support by default. So if you have any ideas of stuff that we're missing, feel free to do a pull request, GitHub issue, send us an email, whatever. The idea is also to allow a very dynamic system where you will be able to build your own templates based on the building blocks that we currently have as attributes. So that means that if you want to build something completely new out of those attributes that we have, just build your own and just use that in MISP. We will have slightly more automation, slightly more and more defined code that targets specific objects for the predefined ones, of course. So we will probably just cast it to simple flat lists if you create your own template when it comes to some of the export formats. But it still gives you a lot of freedom of defining at least on an analyst level on that you want to convey that this information belongs together. Okay. So I already mentioned MISP Galaxy, so 2.0 is one of the long-term plans. For that. So the idea with that is that instead of having the fixed objects that you get from the current galaxies, you would have an editor where you can create your own threat actor objects and so on. So this is of course something more complex, and we want a lot of freedom for this. So as I mentioned before, it's key value pairs that basically make up the complex galaxies. So we want you to be able to create your own information that you want to share without restricting you to strict formats. I mean, our thought behind this is that generally the threat intel stuff that you're sharing is not something that you automate on like you would in an indicator. This is meant for human consumption, so you might have data to share that would not go into our idea of what the default template should look like. Okay. So another thing is the gamification of MISP. So this is a project that is kind of up in the air, but hopefully we'll do it. So the idea is to get people to share more. So we want to have something like a high score system within MISP where people, based on their contributions that is also vetted by the community, can rank up and get scores. This would be an opt-in system, so of course we realize that a lot of the user base will want to remain anonymous or that doesn't want to share who they are, but we also know that a lot of people would want to share that and want to brag about their achievements. So this is something that we're looking into. So again, the role-based views ties in with having the user settings. So it's a chicken and egg problem, so we need the user settings first before we can move on with this. Then you have advanced correlations. Right now, correlations are pretty simple. If a value matches another value, it's a correlation. But for example, what we want to do is, if you have a CIDR block, we want to evaluate whether an IP address is within that. Mm-hmm. And we also want to score different types of correlations differently. But this is something that's an ongoing discussion for a long time. But it's definitely something that we're looking into. And one of the basic elements for this might be that we might move correlations completely out of MISP and have them separately using Redis. So this is something that Rafael has been working on. And then what else? Right, so this is another thing that popped up as a requirement, and it's quite interesting. There are some communities that want to know about who they're exactly exchanging information with. So they want to be able to map all the surrounding MISPs, the MISPs that they're connected to, and so on. So I want an opt-in system that allows you to say, I want to be able to be searched by my partner MISPs, and I want them to be able to know who I am, what organizations I have here, who they're sharing data with, when they're sharing with me. This would be opt-in, of course, so for those communities that want it, they could enable it, and others could opt out, of course. Another thing is that we have this enrichment system now, which is very nice. But we also want to be able to do that while you're using the correlation graphs in MISP. So instead of just taking the values and the attribute to you and enriching them, what we want to do is that if you look at the correlation graph, right-click there and get the enrichments directly there, and then save it in the events from the graph. And I think this is pretty much it for the immediate roadmap. Mm-hmm. So if you have any questions, getting roadmap? No. No questions? Okay.
What's exactly the difference between the different galaxies and the different objects?
Yeah, right. So the idea with galaxies is that it's basically structures that have nothing to do with indicators, but they're threat actors, tools used by threat actors, and so on. So threat intel data that is connected to the event. And objects are basically linking attributes within an event together. So right now, you for example, if you have 100 attributes in an event, some subsets of those belong together, so it's just going to link those together. Right. Anything else? No questions? Okay.